church that is known for your presence again. God, take us back. Yeah. You and I swerve in faith. The power of your name. Heart beating for your kingdom to reign. The church that is known for your presence again. God, take us back.
Hallelujah. Nothing but one.
Amazing God we serve. Amen. We are in a series to, for the last few weeks, we've been in a series called the Committed Series, and we've talked about being committed to a lot of things, and we are in committed to stewardship this month, and I want us to be able to look at that openly and look at it honestly. And allow God to speak to us graciously. God does want to speak to us concerning everything about our lives. And if I were to title this sermon today, it would be God Rewards Good Stewardship. Now, when you look at the Bible and the last song that we just sang, man, that is a powerful, powerful song. God and only God. Boy, do we need Him in the American church and in the church around the world today. We need some good old-fashioned G-O-D. We need God to take over. We need God to be the forefront. We need God to be the preeminent one. The Bible is a beautiful and wonderful book that tells the saga of the human race. It tells the good, it tells the bad, and it tells the ugly. Unfortunately, many do not want to hear that part about the Bible. But the Bible has all of those things in it for us. But it also paints a picture of God and His creation, the plans of a loving Father for His children, and the struggle of life. We have struggles here. We have ups and downs, and we get in trouble, and we get out of trouble, and we make mistakes, and we go forward, and we go backward, and we do a whole lot of things in between. And sometimes we write people off when they find themselves in that position. God never writes us off. He's got hope for His kids to come back to the right plan. It tells of the detours that we often take on our road to heaven. And it tells of His guidance back to the right track. What an amazing book. What an amazing God who is full of grace, love, and forgiveness and acceptance. Sadly, the church has preached a halfway gospel for a number of years, and we really can't afford to do that any longer. We really never could afford to do that, but we certainly cannot afford to do that now. The Bible says what it says, and it means what it says, and we need to read it and believe what's written in it. And there are going to be things that challenge who you are when you read the Bible. How many besides me has ever read something in the Bible and it kind of challenged your identity? Rest of you not being honest. If you've ever read that book, it'll rub up against you. It'll push you in places, and you'll go, is that me, Lord? And the Lord said, yeah, that's you. That's why I got you reading it today. That's you. Because God wants us to be on the right track. That's a loving father. That's a guiding father. That's a dad who comes alongside and says, hey, get out of the street, dummy. You're going to get run over. You know, he doesn't want you to get run over by a truck. So he's going to get you back on the right track. And God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Now let's look at Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 6. A familiar verse of scripture to most of us. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Now, we usually put that in just one category, and we say, well, all I've got to do to be blessed is just pray. Wouldn't that be wonderful if all you had to do was pray? But that's not all of it. God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him, and one of the truths that many Christians fail to understand is that God loves to reward us when we, number one, diligently seek his presence. Number two, when we diligently seek his will. And number three, when we diligently seek his ways. What is your will for my life, God? Somebody told me one time, I have no idea what God wants for me. I said, you must not be talking to God very much. Your dad really wants to tell you. And his ways, what does it mean to seek his ways? It means that we do our best to follow the instructions given out in the Bible. It means that we take the Bible and we lay it open and we diligently try to follow what the Bible teaches. In other words, we don't find somebody that will tell us what we want to hear about this verse of Scripture. I've had people come to me and take a verse of Scripture and try to make it say it what it didn't say. And I would say, it doesn't say that. I say, yeah, but don't you think it could mean that? I say, well, I don't think it could mean that. It cannot mean that gray is orange, to use an illustration. Let's look at some of the instructions given in the Bible. The first five books of the Bible, which are Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, are called the Pentateuch, or the Torah. You may have heard it called the Torah. And what that means, Jewish and Christian oral tradition history says that those first five books was God dictating directly to Moses, and he was writing. So in your mind, get a picture of God standing behind Moses, and Moses with an ink pen. It wasn't an ink pen, but we're going to say it was today. And God was saying, say this, and Moses was writing exactly what he said. And you'll find a lot of times in reading those five books, God said, God said, God said, God said. And Moses was writing exactly what God told him to write down. He just wrote it down word for word and penned it out. Now, God wants to bless us. Let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 1. Now, I'm not going to read all the verses here. I'm going to give you the verses. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 1 through 15. Now it shall come to pass, if you diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God to observe carefully all his commandments which I command you today, that the Lord your God will set you high above all nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you because you obey the voice of the Lord. How many of you want blessings to run over you and knock you down and pick you up and drag you? I want blessings to run over the top of me and grab me and help me. Keep going. Verse 3. Blessed shall you be in the city. Blessed shall you be in the country. Blessed shall you be in the fruit of your body, the produce of your ground, and the increase of your herds, the increase of your cattle, and the offspring of your flocks. Blessed shall you be in your basket and your kneading bowl. Blessed shall you be when you come in, and blessed shall you be when you go out. The Lord will cause your enemies to rise against you and be defeated before your face. They shall come out against you one way and flee before you seven ways. The Lord will command the blessing on you in your storehouses and in all which you set your hand, and he will bless you in the land which the Lord your God is giving you. The Lord will establish you a holy people to himself, just as he has sworn to you, if you keep the commandments of the Lord, your God, and walk in his ways. Now, you can finish out through 15 when you get home. I don't have the time. I need to hurry along for sake of time today. But the Lord tells us there he's going to bless them in three different areas. But the Bible says in Deuteronomy 28, 15 through 68, that if we don't do this, it says we will be cursed. It goes on to say, if you do not obey the Lord, then you will be cursed. You will be cursed militarily. You will be cursed in your prosperity, in your farming, and in your family. And instead of being a blessing to the whole nations of the world, you will be a laughingstock. According to Matthew chapter 6, God rewards us when we pray, when we fast, and when we give. God is going to reward us in heaven is a statement that I often hear, and it's true. But I want you to look with me at Mark chapter 10, verse 29 through 30. Mark chapter 10, verse 29 through 30. Yes, God is going to bless us in heaven, but God wants to bless us down here. So Jesus answered and said, assuredly I say to you, there is no one who has left houses or brothers or sisters or fathers or mothers or wife or children or lands for my sake and the gospel's who shall not receive a hundredfold now in this time, houses and brethren and sisters and mothers and children and lands. But then it also says with persecutions. You will have some challenges in life. And in the age to come, eternal life. God doesn't want to just reward you in heaven with all the things you do down here. God is looking to reward you while you're here on planet Earth. God is looking to take care of you while you're here. The Heavenly Father has promised that if we will follow him in tithing and giving, that he will open the windows of heaven, that he would pour out a blessing that there would not be enough for us to even contain. And he tells them here in the Gospels that anybody that's done anything for me, that is sacrificed for me, I'm going to give you land, I'm going to give you houses, I'm going to give you prosperity, I'm going to give you brothers and sisters and all of those things. And I can testify that that is a true fact. I am standing this morning 3,000 miles from the home that I was born in. I left my home when I was 19 years old, and I have never been back to live more than 10 days in my life. God called me to preach and sent me. I took off. I went in the military and traveled all over the place. And I left all of my family, and when I got up here, I didn't have anything but me. I met a beautiful woman and got married. She's teaching children's church downstairs right now. Oh, you didn't know there's another church going on down there, and there's another one going on at the end of the hallway. And I met a beautiful lady and married, and I got a beautiful wife. I got four daughters. I got how many grandkids? 13 or 14 grandkids, three great-grandkids. And I got, you know, I have a house that I live in and some land I live on. God honors what he said. If we are diligently to follow him, God will reward us. And I don't say that to you this morning to brag. I say that to you to tell you that God honors his written word. He wants to bless you in this life, not just in the life to come. He wants to bless you while you're living here. God not only wants to reward us in heaven, he wants to reward us on earth as well. Several of Jesus' parables illustrate that the Lord's reward of stewardship, tithing, and giving. And I'm not going to read these verses. I'm just going to simply give them to you. And you can read them because they're quite lengthy. But in Luke chapter 19, verse 11 through 27, I advise you, they'll come up on the board as we're going through. I'm just going to kind of tell you the story. It is the story or the parable of the minas. Now, a mina was a coin that had a value of about 60 shekels of silver. What was Jesus saying in this verse? Let's read a little bit of it. Now, as they heard these things, he spoke another parable because he was near Jerusalem and because they thought that the kingdom of God would appear immediately. Therefore, he said, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. So he called 10 of his servants. He called 10 guys that were in his kingdom, and he delivered them 10 minas and said to them, do business until I come. But his citizens hated him, and they sent a delegation after him saying, we will not have this man to reign over us. And so it was that when he had returned, having received the kingdom, he then commanded the servants to whom had been given the money to be called to him that he might know how much every man had gained by trading. Then came the first, saying, Master, your minas have earned 10 minas. And he said unto him, Well done, good servant, because you have been faithful in a very little, have authority over 10 cities. And the second came, saying, Master, your mina has earned 5 minas. Likewise, he said to him, You also be over 5 cities. Then another came, saying, Master, here is your mina, which I have kept put away in a handkerchief, for I feared you, because you are an adulterous man. You collect what you did not deposit and reap what you did not sow. And he said to him, Out of your own mouth I will judge you, you wicked servant. You knew that I was an austere man, collecting what I did not deposit, reaping what I did not sow. Why did you not put my money in the bank, that at my coming I might have collected it with interest? And he said to those who stood by, Take the mina from him and give it to him who has 10. But they said to him, Master, he has 10. For I say to you, that to everyone who has will be given, and from him who does not have, even that what he has will be taken away from him. But bring here those enemies of mine who did not want to reign over them, and slay them here before me. What in the world is the Lord saying in that verse of Scripture? He's saying kind of a couple of different things. He taught 2 primary lessons. First, while the kingdom of God would certainly come in all its power and glory, it would not come right away. He was saying a long period of time would elapse between Jesus' first coming and his second coming. And right now, we're waiting on the second coming of Jesus Christ. A long period of time has elapsed between that. And that's what that verse of Scripture is telling us there. And second, he said to them, Let me finish my thought here. Second, in the meantime, Jesus' followers were expected to use the gifts they were given to advance the kingdom of God. So whatever God has given us, however amount of money that God has given us, we're to use that to advance the kingdom of God. But when you look at verse 17, you really see the power of the verse. And he said to him, Well done, you good and faithful servant, because you were faithful in very little, have authority over 10 cities. This is a point that God wants to reward us down here on planet Earth while we are here. God wants to take and give us some rewards while we're living on the earth, not everything when we get to heaven. But God is not going to give more money or more anything to an unfaithful servant if we're not faithful with what he has already given us. God is interested in building his kingdom. That is why he's going to entrust funds to you and I. That's why God allows us to work. That's why we're Christians, so that we can promote and give to the kingdom of God. That is why he's going to entrust funds to people who are proving to him that they will be a good stewards of those things which he gives them. Matthew 25, 14 through 30, Jesus makes a similar point with the talents. God gives talents to each one of us according to our ability and expects us to use those talents for his kingdom purposes. You will never see God's miraculous power given to poor stewards. In fact, if you're a poor steward, he will take the talent you have and give it to someone else. If you look at Acts, the 2nd chapter, and I encourage you to read that whole chapter, we see the first Spirit-filled Christians so in love with God that they actually collected all of their possessions and sold their goods and gave everyone of what anybody that had a need, they just began to give to them. And God responded from heaven with generosity of their selfishness, and he responded with heaven with pouring out miracles. They abandoned themselves to God and his purpose, and God applauded them from heaven by pouring out his power, and there was healing, and there was deliverance, and there was church growth, and there was all kinds of things that took place simply because these people honored God with the gifts that he had given them. In essence, poor stewards lose rewards for good stewards receive rewards. That's a pretty simple concept. He rewards those who are diligent, and he curses those who are not diligent. And, you know, I know that we don't like to hear this part of the gospel, but it is a part of the gospel. It's found in the New Testament. In Matthew 24, 45 through 17, Jesus asked a powerful question. Matthew 24, 45 through 47. It's a very powerful question. Who then is a faithful and wise servant? That is a tremendous question. Whom his master made ruler over his household to give them food in due season. Blessed is that servant whom his master, when he comes, will find him so doing. Assuredly, I say to you that he will make him ruler over all his goods. When the Lord returns, he will find, if he, He will find you being a good and faithful servant. Will he? That's the question that he asks us today. Are you doing your best with what God has given you? Do you know where your money goes each month? Do you know? Are you telling your money where to go? Or is it just gone and you have no accountability of it? Are you tithing, giving, witnessing, and praying? Luke 16:11, Jesus said, If you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to you the true riches? This shows that God actually uses money to test our hearts. Money tests our stewardship and our trustworthiness. Did you know that Jesus spent 30% of his time teaching on money for a reason? The majority of the parables are about money. He knew that us humans would struggle with it because we put so much emphasis on it and so much trust in it. We trust the almighty dollar. We struggle to make it and we struggle to keep it. Look with me at Matthew 6, 19 through 21. Emphasis on 21. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and there and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. That's a very direct statement. Where your heart is, who does it belong to? Who does your heart belong to? Your mouth may tell one story, but your checkbook will either validate or refute your claim of who owns your heart. We are the ones who are responsible for our finances. Nobody else is responsible. We are the stewards of our own money. We should pray and get God's counsel before we spend money. Now, I'm not talking about living expenses or buying a cup of coffee or something like that. I'm talking about before we go out and get in debt, we ought to talk to God and consult with him and see if it's okay. Lord, is it okay for me to buy that car, or should I buy this car that's $20,000 cheaper? Is it all right for me to buy this or that instead of just going ahead and saying, hey, I'm going to get that, and then trying to figure out later how you're going to pay for it? God truly desires to bless us. Look at Genesis 12:2. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. Why does God bless you? So you can be a blessing. 2 Corinthians 9:8. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work. God does not want you to be just struggling from check to check. You ought to shout anyway. God was so ingenious when he set up his financial program of tithing and giving. It is the best insurance you can have against economic failure. The best insurance you can have. I shared this with you a week ago, and I want to share it with you again to get into what I need to close with today. In the United States, Christians earned in 1998, the body of Christ around the world, that means all the Christians in the world, earned an estimated equivalent of an estimated amount of dollars of $15.2 trillion. That means in 1998, all the Christians of the world earned $15.2 trillion. That's a lot of money. The total amount given to ministry was $270 billion, which is 1.8%, not the 10% prescribed by God. But the record was worse in America. In the United States, Christians earned an estimated $5.2 trillion and gave $92 billion, which is about 1.7%, not the 10% which God prescribed. We have to know who we are as a body of Christ around the world. Not just in this house, around the world. Who are we? Now I want to take a look at our local giving over the last 15 years. As most of you know, I am very careful, and we have instructed our bookkeeper in this local church to tithe every penny that comes into this church. Every penny that comes in, we tithe out. That means we tithe on the tithe, and we tithe on every offering that is given. Whoever it's for, if we have a guest speaker and we receive an offering for that guest speaker and it's $500-$600, well, we take $50 out and say, sorry, bud, we're going to take that out. That belongs to God, because every offering that comes in this house has to be tithe. And then hopefully that guest speaker will take and tithe on that amount. I asked a bookkeeper for just a simple record of the giving of offerings, not the tithing. So this is just offerings. I asked her to give me the tithe so I could do the math. I mean, I can do math pretty good. And she gave me that. So we gave, over the last 15 years, we gave an average of $45 a month tithe. So that means we as a local church only give $450 a month. You do that times 12, it equals $5,400 a year. Over a 15-year period of time is $81,000. Roughly over 100-plus people gave $81,000. For 100 people plus to give that much money, it would mean that each person gives $51.43 per year, or $4.28 a week. This is just offering. It's not tithing. Outside offerings that came into this local church because of our tithing was $222,000 over a 15-year period of time, or $1,233 a month. We had offerings that we have companies that give to us: Chevron, J.R. Johnson, Sherwin-Williams, Bear Consulting, and I could just list. And somebody said, do you keep a list? Well, of course I do. They need to be thanked for what they're doing and helping in this, all our endeavors that we do. So if the outside was $222,000, the inside was $81,000, we fall in the category of those Christians who are giving 1.7% of our income. But yet we want God to pour out the miraculous in our lives. Don't shout me down when I'm preaching good. That means that outside sources gave $783 a month more than we did. You think pastors don't keep up with all this? Let me tell you why we keep up with all of this. The last act that Jesus Christ did, the last public act, he did a lot of private acts with the disciples, but the last public act that he did, the Bible says that he went to church. He went to the temple, and he sat where? He sat over next to the treasury, and he watched how people gave into it. And we know the story, the little lady that came that had two pennies, and she put the two pennies in, and Jesus said she gave more than everybody in the world, or everybody in the house. She gave more because she gave everything she had. There was a reason she gave everything she had. Do you know that she was a student of the Bible? Let me tell you how I know she understood that. Obviously, she had read the Bible story about Elijah and the widow and the famine and no food, and how that Elijah came to the widow's house and said, make me a little cake. She says, mister, I just have a little bit of oil and a little bit of flour, and I'm going to make a pancake for me and my son, and we're going to eat it and die. He said, if you'll make me one first, if you'll take care of God first, everything will be all right. And the Bible said that she made a cake for him, and the oil in her pot did not run out until the famine was over. God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek his presence, his will, and his ways. The information I gave you tells two stories. It tells our story of giving and God's story of rewarding this church anyway. He honored what we had. As a church, I could only instruct tithing on what came in, and I was very faithful to do that. And because of that, he ensured that $222,000 came into this church above the offering. And I'm saying that to you today and challenging you, let us be faithful in our giving as well as our tithing. When Malachi wrote, God's command, prove me, in Malachi chapter 3, prove me now herewith. He was addressing a generation that is just like our generation. This was what's happening in Malachi's day. Materialism was rampant. Divorce was up. Church leaders were backslidden. The temple or church suffered both neglect and abuse. Good was evil and evil was good. You know, they're doing that today. They're calling good evil and evil good. That's what they did then, and that's what's happening now. God promised judgment against sorcerers, adulterers, false swearers, and those who oppress the defenseless. He also promised to deal with those who do not fear God. Had God not been unchangeable in his word, he would have destroyed them right then. I find it interesting that the Jews responded to God's message. They wanted to know how to return to God and immediately address their practice of robbing him in tithe and offerings. When they said, God, how do we return? He addressed tithing and offering in Malachi chapter 3. You should read the whole book of Malachi. It's an excellent book on this. He informed them that they were indeed cursed and then offered space to repent. You want to come give me some music? Revival came with genuine financial reform as the first step. I believe that this offer is still valid for the church today in America and around the world. He has promised to forgive in response to true repentance. Now, I don't know where all of you fall. I don't check the records of each individual, to be honest with you. I don't really care about that. I just look at the total report that's given to me quarterly. I just look at the total income report. But I know one thing. I do not want to fall in the category of a Christian that only gives 1.7% of my income to God. The minimum I can do is 10%. That is the tithe. That is the very minimum that I can do. Then there was a free will offering that's above the tithe. Somebody says, well, I tithe, that's all I need to do. You need to read the Bible. It says you rob me in tithing and in offerings. But when we don't tell our money where to go, when we have no idea where our finances go at the end of the month, then when we go to church, there's none left for God. When I make a budget, God is first and everything else is second. When I get my paycheck, the first check I write is not to the mortgage or not to pay for a car. The first check that I write is to God's house. Because the Bible instructs me to give my first tenth to Him. My first of my first tenth. Somebody asked me one time, well, how come God honored Abel and did not honor Cain? It was because of the type of offering. The Bible says, and in the space of time, Cain brought an offering to the Lord. And Abel brought the first fruits of his flock. And God honored Abel and rejected Cain. So I challenge you, when you get your money from whatever, how you get it, besides pastoring, I work a construction job. I'm up every morning at 5 a.m. and on a job every day at 6:30. I work 9 to 10 hours a day, 5 days a week, just like many of you. When that deposit hits me on Thursday, my first check my wife writes on Thursday is to this local body. Make sure that this body, that God gets his tenth. And then you give in that check, you make sure you got crossed out on offering. And do I check that? You bet I check that. That's my responsibility as the head of the house. You bet I check that. I've been married to her 37 years. She ain't missed in 37 years. She's not about to miss. But my responsibility is to look. It's my responsibility. When God came to Adam and Eve in the cool of the day, he didn't say, hey, where are y'all? He said, Adam, where are you? Hey, guy in charge, guy that I gave authority to, guy that I created first, where are you? I got to talk with you. You're not doing your job. So this morning I want to challenge you. That last song we sang just really blessed me. And knowing what I know about God, you know, in Acts chapter 2, how he just poured out miraculous power. We look at that and say, oh, that was just the Holy Ghost coming. A whole lot more going on there than that. A whole lot more going on. Man, I want to please him. One of these days, the eastern sky is going to split and Jesus is going to step out. It'll be too late to cry to him then. There won't be an opportunity for me to say, God, can you wait another 5? This morning, if you're here with me in this room and you have not invited Jesus Christ to be the Lord of your life and to forgive you of your sins and to come into your heart, that is the greatest need you have. You need salvation. You need Jesus Christ to forgive your sins. I made that choice as a 19-year-old boy. You need that. 42 years later, he's still as good as he ever was. If you have not done that and you would like to make that confession today, would you just put your hand up? I'd like to invite Jesus Christ into my heart. Anybody in this room today, you want to ask Christ to forgive you of your sins, just put your hand up and right back down. I see your hand. You can put it down. I see your hand back there. I see your hand. You can put your hands down. I'd like the whole church to stand with me if you would. We want to pray with these that raise their hand. We want to pray the sinner's prayer. And I'd like for all of you that are Christians to pray this with them. Can you do that? Can we pray that together with these that raise their hands? They want to accept Christ. Repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I ask you to forgive me of my sins and to come into my heart and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness. I know that I'm not perfect, but I want to serve you. I ask you to help me from this time forward to put you first. Give me strength. Give me courage. And give me help. In Jesus' name, amen. Give the Lord a hand clap this morning, church. Amen. Hallelujah.